people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newspeak South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Drone terror attacks rock Jammu's Indian Air Force Station. Families of Afghan Taliban live in Islamabad, says Pak Interior Minister Sheikh Rashid Ahmed. An exiled activist protests across Europe against Pak atrocities. Although guns have fallen silent on the LOC after the renewed pact on the ceasefire between India and Pakistan, nefarious activities of Islamabad have not stopped yet in Jammu and Kashmir. The terror-breeding nation has devised multi-pronged strategies to hurt India's sovereignty and integrity. It is now relying on drone technology to carry out attacks and sending in arms and trucks into India. Indicating a new terror challenge for India, two explosive-laden drones were recently used to attack the Air Force station in its Jammu district.
India witnessed a glimpse of modern-day drone warfare as two unmanned aerial vehicles or UAVs dropped sophisticated improvised explosive device payloads at the Air Force base in Jammu recently. One of them fell on a building, creating a hole in the roof, and the other exploded in an open area. In the first terrorist attack of its kind, two IAF personnel suffered minor injuries in the explosion that happened within 6 minutes of each other. This is the second attack on an Indian military airfield in recent years. On January 2, 2016, four Pakistan-backed Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorists attacked the Pathankot airbase, killing 7 security personnel. Initial investigations by Indian authorities suggest that the recent attack was carried out by Pakistan-based terror outfit Lashkar-e-Taiba. It appears to be part of Pakistan's larger sinister conspiracy against India. By using such drones fitted with explosives, terrorists can penetrate into Indian territory without actually having to infiltrate terrorists or engage with the armed forces in encounters. Removing the human element from the equation also allows perpetrators a greater degree of deniability.
Geographical proximity of Pathankot or Jammu Air Base. Jammu Air Base is only 14 kilometers from Indo-Pak border. That attracts the attention of Pakistan Army. And this drone attack is first of its kind in the history. And it's my belief that it is just an experiment. It is a dummy run. Pakistan will try to enhance and scale up the type of drone attack on our air bases. But they want to show their presence. And therefore, these Lashkar-e-Tauba and their terrorists, they are trying to create show presence by resorting to such activities. But it's my belief that our operation all out and our preparations are sound. We'll be able to locate them and thwart their attempts.
Drone terror threat continues to hover on India's military installations in Jammu and Kashmir. After this attack, drones were spotted 5 times for the 3 consecutive days in different areas of the Union Territory, which escaped when security forces opened fire. According to experts, this is the first time that drones are being used in an attack on defense installations in the country. However, there have been several incidents of Pakistan-based terrorists using drones in the border areas of Jammu and Kashmir and Punjab to drop arms, ammunition, drugs and money to fuel terrorism in the region.
These kind of drone activities, it is 100% sure that none other than Pakistan is involved in this, and Pakistan is trying to do all this. You see, drone activities and all these things, they are happening because of the Kashmiri talks that the Prime Minister is having, and also in the wake of you know, the elections that the Prime Minister is proposed to have in Jammu and Kashmir. And the Prime Minister also said that democracy will be restored in Kashmir. So Pakistan has to play foul. Pakistan has to indulge into all these terror activities. And this is absolutely very, very shocking and horrible on part of Pakistan.
Last week, terrorists also lobbed grenades at a CRPF post in Srinagar, leaving four civilians injured. On June 27, terrorists shot dead a special police officer of Jammu and Kashmir Police at his home, along with his wife and daughter. However, in a major setback to Pakistan, the security forces gunned down two Pakistan-backed terrorists in an encounter, including the Lashkar-e-Taiba top terror commander Nadeem Abrar Bhatt, who was involved in several killings of security forces and innocent Kashmiri civilians.
पिछले कुछ दिन में इनोसेंट को सिविलियन हो या पुलिस वाला जो कहीं छुट्टी पर जाता है अपने घर जाते हैं या मस्जिद के पास नमाज पढ़ने जाते हैं उसको टारगेट कर रहे हैं लोग एक सोसाइटी में एक कश्मीर में एक फियर साइकोसिस एक ऐसा माहौल बनाना चाहते हैं कि इनको डर है आने वाले दिन में यहाँ काफी टूरिस्ट आएंगे लोग आएंगे यहाँ पर अमन चैन होगा उसको ये देखना नहीं चाहते हैं कुछ पॉजिटिव टॉक भी चल रहा है उसको भी डिस्टर्ब करना चाहता है इनका ये मेन मकसद है ये नहीं चाहता कि यहाँ पर शांति हो लोग यहाँ पर विकासशील हो डेवलपमेंट हो लोग दो पैसा कमाए
Over 100 days at the line of control have passed without a bullet being fired between India and Pakistani forces. But there is no commitment from Islamabad to stop sponsoring terror. At a time of increased vigil on the border, Pakistan-backed terror groups have been adopting and adapting terror tactics from other theaters like drones to drop weapons, tunnels to infiltrate terrorists and introducing IEDs in Kashmir. This puts a question mark on Pakistan's intent as to whether it genuinely seeks peace at the border or it is hatching a bigger conspiracy. And peace gestures were merely a tactical move.
Pakistan's complicity in providing leadership and shelter to terrorists is getting exposed at all fronts. Pakistan-based terror groups are not the only ones enjoying the Pakistani security establishment's patronage. The Afghan Taliban, including its most lethal component, the Haqqani network, also remain alive and well in Pakistan. This truth was recently conceded by none other than Pakistan's Federal Minister of Interior himself. Have a look.
Pakistan's state-sponsored terror exposed. Top minister exposes Pakistani deep state. The unholy alliance of Pak government and the Taliban unmasked yet again. Islamabad's claims to completely dismantle terror infrastructure in the country and withdraw its support from the terror organizations operating in Afghanistan have fallen flat. In an interview aired by a private Pakistani TV channel, Pakistan's Interior Minister Sheikh Rashid Ahmed conceded that families of Afghanistan Taliban live in his country. Including in the capital city of Islamabad, and sometimes the members of the insurgent outfit are treated in local hospitals.
Whenever Pakistan is caught something doing something illegal, Pakistan's first instinct is to deny it completely. Of course, the rest of the world knows that Pakistan is not telling the truth, and then after a passage of time, Pakistan slowly starts to admit it and then says it openly. What happens is, the illegal act that Pakistan commits, even if legality does not change, it becomes permissible by international standards.
Earlier in June, Pakistani Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi denied the presence of Taliban sanctuaries in Pakistan in an exclusive interview to Afghanistan News Channel. Not only did he defend the Taliban attacks brazenly, but also issued veiled threats to the Kabul establishment to either fall in line and give in to Taliban demands or face consequences. In this nearly an hour-long interview, not once did Qureshi concede that Taliban were terrorists. In fact, he almost called them freedom fighters.
Again, if you try and create this impression that the violence is high because of Taliban. Let me just finish. The violence is higher because of Taliban. Again, that would be an exaggeration.
Several reports have revealed that the Taliban Leadership Council continues to operate out of Pakistani Balochistan's capital. The former tribal areas, which have now been merged into the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province, have seen a resurgence of the Taliban's local affiliates. As per a report by Voice of America quoting locals, the donations to the Afghan Taliban are on the upswing in Pakistan border regions as the militant group intensifies attacks against Afghan forces. In Balochistan, some observers say the sanctuaries and support networks are part of Islamabad's long-standing efforts to shape the political system in Afghanistan.
Certainly, the groundwork that Taliban needs to do has been done in total conjunction with the Pakistani authorities. There is complete coordination in this particular matter. So, Pakistan is being used as a springboard to enter Afghanistan, to invade Afghanistan. Everybody knows it.
While Pakistan always denies supporting the Afghan Taliban and recently joined the United States, Russia and China informally opposing a return of the group's Islamic Emirate, it has done little to hamper the Taliban's military machine on its own soil. Taliban are Pakistan's protege, secure in their safe havens, launching attacks in Afghanistan and returning home to headquarters. Islamabad has even denied hosting American bases in Pakistan for military action inside Afghanistan to maintain a counter-terrorism infrastructure in future. Experts say Pakistan has a massive plan drawn out for post-US withdrawal from Afghanistan, and they only fear for its nowhere close to peace or harmony.
Let's now talk about Pakistan's hypocrisy in dealing with terrorism and human rights. It is here the state and non-state actors both are engaged in spreading violence and carrying out gross violations of human rights. A large number of people from various ethnic communities in Pakistan have migrated abroad and continue to raise their voice against injustice. They are now demanding intervention by the international community to protect the civilian lives that have been facing forceful abductions, tortures and even killings.
Such protests by Pakistani dissidents in the West are common nowadays. They are Baloch, the Sindhis, the Pashtuns and even Mohajis who have been facing persecution and other brutalities in the hands of Pakistani security forces, terrorist groups and criminal gangs. Their family members, friends and even party workers have gone missing. Some were tortured and even killed by the security agencies. The Baloch National Movement has been raising the issue of enforced disappearances and extrajudicial killings in Balochistan by holding protests in Europe and other parts of the world.
The Pakistani intelligence agencies, including Pakistani army, are abducting Baloch political activists, Baloch writers, Baloch doctors, Baloch intelligentsia, and Baloch human rights activists across Balochistan. Dr. Deen Mohammad Baloch is an example. He's been missing for more than 12 years. Zakir Majid is another example. So there are thousands of Baloch students, doctors, lawyers who are still missing in Pakistani secret torture cells.
For the past several years, the Baloch have been raising their voice at the United Nations in Geneva. At the 47th regular session of the UN Human Rights Council, the Baloch Voice Association organized a 3D photo and poster exhibition at the Broken Chair to highlight the plight of indigenous Baloch people in Pakistan's largest and resource-rich province of Balochistan. Pakistan Army has intensified operations against the Baloch in the past decade with an aim to provide easy access to China for its multi-billion dollar Belt and Road Initiative. The Baloch, who have been demanding freedom from Pakistan, allege that the Pakistan Army is even providing backing to terror groups in the region to target Baloch women and children.
their agencies, their secret forces, they take human beings from the streets, from their houses, from schools, from colleges, from universities, from the bazaar, daylight, in front of many people, in front of many witnesses. They take them, then they disappear them. And this practice has been continued from more than a decade. The number of cases has increased so much that there are reports that more than 40,000 Baloch people are missing. We have received reports that many have been recovered, many dead bodies have been recovered over there. They tortured, mutilated dead bodies of Baloch missing persons who got disappeared by the forces. Then they throw their dead bodies sometimes in streets, sometimes in a desert, sometimes on a roadside.
Human rights violations in Pakistan are widespread. The Muhajirs, a large Muslim community who migrated to Pakistan from India during the partition in 1947, are even facing the worst persecution. The Mutahida Qaumi Movement staged a protest at Pakistan High Commission in London to apprise the international community of the state atrocities against the Muhajirs in Pakistan's Sindh province. The army and other security forces in Pakistan are involved in the economic and physical genocide of Muhajirs going on since 1992, with the launch of deadliest military crackdown.
Moving on, in a major setback to Islamabad, the Global Anti-Terror Financing Watchdog, which is the Financial Action Task Force, last week decided to retain Pakistan in its grey list for failing to adequately investigate and prosecute senior leaders and commanders of UN-designated terror groups present in the country. Despite remaining in grey list of Financial Action Task Force for years now, Pakistan failed to comply with 27-point action plan. We have a report.
Pakistan continues to face global embarrassment for carrying a tag of terror-promoting state as it failed to convince FATF, the Global Money Laundering and Terrorist Financing Watchdog. Its hopes of being let off the FATF's grey list were dashed once again, as the 39-member grouping decided to keep it on the list and even added more tasks. By failing to prosecute senior leaders of UN-proscribed terror groups, Islamabad is yet to fulfill the toughest of the 27 conditions, due to which the Paris-based UN watchdog has not yet removed Pakistan from its grey list of countries which are under increased monitoring. Urging Islamabad to effectively act against terror funding modules and terror masterminds, FATF's President Dr. Marcus Player said that Pakistan will remain on the grey list till it addresses all items on the original action plan agreed to in June 2018.
Pakistan remains under increased monitoring. One key action item still needs to be completed, which concerns the investigation and prosecution of senior leaders and commanders of UN-designated terror groups. In addition to this, a separate process has been taking place over the past few years. Back in 2019, the FATF's regional partner, the APG, the Asia Pacific Group, identified a number of serious issues during its assessment of Pakistan's entire anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financing system. Pakistan is still failing to effectively implement the global FATF standards across a number of areas. This means the risks of money laundering remain high, which in turn can fuel corruption and organized crime.
In June 2018, Pakistan was put on FATF's grey list and given a 27-point action plan to implement in order to be taken off the list. Failing to deliver all 27 targets at its last plenary meeting in February 2021, FATF retained Pakistan in its grey list and urged the country to complete an action plan to counter terror financing before June 2021, but it was saved again and now has been given another extension. This repeated story has also raised questions over FATF's credibility, for it has proven toothless against a terror state. However, FATF somehow noted that Pakistan had completed 26 of the 27 items mentioned in its 2018 action plans, but this was insufficient for removal from the grey list.
Pakistan has not done a number of actions, although they claim that they have worked on 26 points out of 27 points which FATF given them. But FATF is also quite clear that a number of persons and entities are working on behalf of the UN designated terrorists. So now they have cashed on to say that you have not taken any action against them, whether it is financial action or it is investigation or it is actually punishing them. So that's one part of it. As far as blacklist is concerned, only 3 votes are required to save them from blacklist, which was expected. So as China, Turkey and Organization of Islamic Countries, so this is these 3 votes are assured. So they couldn't have gone into blacklist, but they were trying to get out of grey list, and rightly so, they have been put back in grey list.
With Pakistan's continuation in the grey list, it is increasingly becoming difficult for Islamabad to get financial aid from the International Monetary Fund, World Bank, Asian Development Bank and the European Union, thus further enhancing problems for the debt-ridden nation, which is in a precarious financial situation. Regardless of all financial issues, Pakistan continues to use terrorism as an instrument of its state policy. Days after a powerful explosion took place near UN-designated terrorist Hafiz Saeed's residence in Lahore, a Pakistani journalist has revealed that Saeed was indeed at home when the bomb went off and was the target of the attack. Despite being sentenced for jail term, Pakistan quietly shifted Hafiz to his house in Lahore from Kot Lakhpat jail, where he continues to manage Lashkar-e-Taiba. This revelation has exposed Pakistan's real intent towards terrorism. Whenever Islamabad has faced a decision on its grey list status, it carries out cosmetic actions against these leaders that appear to be aimed more at ensuring a better outcome for itself at the FATF. Its arrest and conviction of Hafiz Saeed, Zakir Rahman Lakhvi and Masood Azhar in terror financing cases, the passing of anti-terrorism and money laundering laws in the Pakistan Assembly to bring them in line with the FATF mandated international norms, and the publication of new lists of terrorists at various times, all were timed before FATF reviews of Pakistan's status in February 2021. Recently, the Pakistan government also approved new rules for the forfeiture and auction of properties and assets related to anti-money laundering cases and the transfer of investigation and prosecution of such cases from police and provincial authorities to specialized agencies.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nin.com. This is Shreya Savijay, signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.